Yesterday, we talked to wives, but today, look out, we're going to talk to you husbands. Now, wives, I want you to listen too. In fact, I want all of you to listen, but husbands, you listen especially well as we talk directly to you today on the podcast. Hope you'll join us.
Welcome to Everyday Truth with Kurt Skelly. We believe the Bible is true and relevant to everyone, everywhere, every day. If today's conversation is a help to you, take a moment to leave a review or share it with a friend. Thanks for listening. Now, let's join Kurt for today's episode.
Hey friends, welcome back. We're in Ephesians chapter 5, as most of you know. And we spent last episode talking to wives. And today we're going to talk to you husbands. So I hope you are buckled up and ready to go. I think we'll all be helped. And as I said yesterday, this is not just a discussion for husbands. It's for all of us to understand. And, you know, I think one of the most important times to talk to people about marriage is before marriage. I mean, think about it. When's the best time to get a doctor trained? Before he's a doctor, right? I want a doctor who knows a whole lot about doctoring before he practices on me. And I think that's important in marriage. It's important that we understand a whole lot about marriage before we get married. Why? Because then it's too late. We don't want to have on-the-job training, right? And there's enough of that anyway. So what can we know the Bible teaches about our role in marriage? We talked a bit yesterday about a wife's role. And now today, let's talk about that husband. So Ephesians 5, and look at verse number 25. Ephesians 5, 25, you'll recognize the verse immediately. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. So, wow, what an expectation. Husbands, love your wives. The word love here is the word agape. Love your wives as Christ also loved the church. I cannot think of a more convicting qualifier in all the Bible than that. And so I'm a husband, that I am to love my wife the way that Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. So, whew, that is a tall order. So think about it. First of all, what is the imperative? The imperative is love your wives. And the context of that imperative is what we've talked about for the last couple of days, and that is spirit fullness, that we're to be filled with the Spirit of God. It's only as I am controlled by and empowered by the Holy Spirit that I can effectively love my wife. Why? Because it must be the love of God through me. It's God's love. That's why the Bible says in Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23, I think, that the fruit of the Spirit, the production, the evidence of the Spirit is love, right? Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, it goes on. But what is the primary evidence of being controlled by God's Spirit? Love. So the Bible says in that context, husbands, love your wives. And then I think to help us to understand how to love our wives, the illustration is brought in of Christ. So we follow Christ. We imitate. That's a really good way to think about the word follow. We imitate Christ. So if we're a little bit confused about what it means to love our wives, if we're confused about the quality of that love and how that love is expressed, then we need only to think of how did Christ love his church? And that's the point. So husbands, love your wives as Christ also loved the church. And then here it is, and gave himself for it. So first of all, we do that too. We'll talk about that later on, maybe in tomorrow's podcast, but we love our wives the way Christ loved the church. So think about that. We love, how did Christ love the church? He loved the church by giving himself entirely for, right? So he gave himself for us. That we read that and studied that actually at the beginning of this chapter. Walk in love as Christ also hath loved us and hath given himself for us. And there's a great principle to understand, and that is that love gives. That really is the action of love, that love gives itself to its object. It gives. Love sacrifices would be another verb to use there. So think about John 3:16, one of the famous verse, most famous verses in all the Bible. For God so loved the world that he gave. Or 1 John chapter 3 and verse 16. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us. That's how we understand God's love, because he gave, he laid down his life. And then here in Ephesians 5, twice, walk in love, Christ gave himself. Here, Ephesians 5:25, Christ hath loved, the way Christ loved us and hath given himself for us. So how does this apply in practical terms to our marriage? What it applies to is that we put the object of our love ahead of us. So we live lives of sacrifice for our wives. It's I'm living for you. I would give myself for you. I would lay down my life for you. I value you more than I value my own life. I value your comfort more than I value mine. I value your safety more than I value mine. I will stand in front of, I will take a bullet for, I will. That's love. Love gives. It's a daily sacrifice. I call this the initiation of love. Love, the initiate. Christ loved us with an initiating love, right? The Bible says we love him because, fill in that blank. We love him because he first loved us. So when it comes to loving our wives, men, that we love her with an initiating love. So how often are we in a marriage relationship as men? You know, we have an issue in marriage and our wife is the one that initiates maybe forgiveness or initiates reconciliation or initiates faith or initiates. No. Love ought to, the love that a husband has for a wife ought to cause him to initiate. That I'm willing to be the one that initiates faith and reconciliation and service and communication and all of it. Why? Because love initiates. And what an important principle that we're learning, and what a great example in Jesus. But the teaching doesn't end in verse 25. Sometimes we read verse 25 and make that the end all, be all of a husband's relationship to his wife. And that is not true, because the passage goes on to talk about some more qualities of, descriptors of Christ's love for the church and therefore of our responsibility to our wives. So look at those. Ephesians 5:25, love your wives as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. But then verse number 26, that. So anytime you see the word that, it helps us understand purpose. That he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word. So the point here is that when Christ loved the church and gave himself for it, was he giving himself for the church so that they could have a one-time pass into freedom, to get that ticket to heaven? Was that the purpose for Christ's sacrifice on the cross, that we would just have the absence of the negative, not have to go to hell? No, Christ didn't save us so that now we are free moral agents that just do our own thing, absent a relationship from him. No, he saved us, watch this, for himself. He saved us for a purpose. So we think about when we're saved, we're justified. Right? We've talked about this. But justification also inaugurated a process in our life called sanctification. whereby we are made more like Jesus day by day by the indwelling Holy Spirit, who uses his word to form into us the very character of Christ. That's sanctification. That's what this is saying, that Christ loved us. He hath given himself for us that he might sanctify and cleanse us, that we would become more and more like him, that we would be clean through the word of God, the washing of the water by the word. So the point here is that we were saved for a relationship and an abiding fellowship in which there would be growth and sanctification. And so it is in a marriage that when we get married, we essentially give ourselves to the other, right? I give myself to you. That happens in a marriage physically, spiritually, emotionally, socially. So what's the point? The point is that marriage doesn't begin and end at that consummating point at the day of your wedding. No, we are set apart to each other to grow together, to be identified with each other, that he might sanctify and cleanse it. See that verse number 26, with the washing of the water by the word. So there's an ongoing relationship. And can I just say that in a marriage, husbands, we have a responsibility to stay engaged. It's not like I conquered, I'm married. You know, now she's my wife. You know, I'm moving on to bigger and better things, and she can do the laundry and do the dishes and have my meals made. And, no, what a superficial way to look at a relationship. No, it's that there's an ongoing, abiding, growing fellowship together. So it's an initiating love, but then it's an including love that we are now in union and in fellowship together. I think that's important for us to understand. Can I give you one more before we have to quit for today? Look at verse number 27, there's another purpose statement, that he might present it to himself, the church, Christ, might present it to himself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. So Christ has a vested interest in his bride. For her to be holy, for her to abide with him, for her ultimately to spend eternity with him, that he might present her to himself. So we talked about how should a husband love his wife? I think first with an initiating love, you know, he loved her first. Also with an including love, it's an abiding fellowship. But how about this one, identifying? I was looking for the word, with an identifying love. So Christ saved the church that the church would be identified with him, that he might present it to himself. So when a wife marries her husband, typically she takes his name. Does that mean that she's less important? No, it means that they now are identified with each other. They share a name. They are identified as one. They've come together. And that's what the Bible teaches, that Christ identifies with us, his bride. We identify with him. That's why we call ourselves Christians. We call ourselves by his name. And that's what God expects for a godly marriage. So there's more to say, and the passage certainly is not over, but our time today is over. So we're going to quit right there, and we'll jump right back into it next episode. I hope you'll join us. God bless you, my friends.